This is Semantic Web Technologies, lecture number 2, part 6. Today we are talking about how to model classes and relations, on which we then later on can make facts about individuals in RDF. So today we are talking about RDFS, which is the RDF schema language. And if we want to try to place the RDF schema language within the semantic web technology stack that we already have seen, we see we have come up pretty much way up inside the structure. So we have started in the beginning with a URI to address things and the HTTP protocol to exchange messages. Then we have talked about RDF, how to create facts, how to formulate facts and express facts. And what we do now is, of course, we have to build or think of models about which or from which these facts then in the end can be made. So we are now on the level of the models and we are talking about RDF schema. So what is RDF schema and why do we use it? Okay, just imagine we have an application program, and within this application program we might access and define RDF data. But we can only do this, of course, if the application program knows which terms and classes to use. So, for example, if there is a name, a title, a year, or something like that, or if there are a name, a block, a phone number inside the data, or if there is an author and some citation. So, the problem is, do I know all the terms in advance, or is there some way to look this up? So, are all the terms that I have used in the program really correct? Is there something where I can look up and where I can see if this is a correct usage of the data? So this is, of course, really a problem. So are there probably more logical relations between the terms we have seen here? You can't express this in RDF. Therefore, we are in need of a schema definition language. And therefore, we have a language that is called RDF schema. And officially, of course, the name of RDF schema is the RDF vocabulary description language, and it's a way to define RDF vocabulary, to define classes, to define relations between classes and stuff like that. So, RDF schema, it's pretty old, so the first draft has been in April 1998, and it has become a first W3C recommendation in 2004. And what it does? RDF defines a data model for the creation of RDS statements. So you have the possibility to define classes, and then, of course, to instantiate these classes, so define individuals, instances of these classes. And you do this with the keyword RDF type. RDF type, we do already know. Now, on the other hand, we also can define new kinds of properties, and we can post restrictions on these properties. And, of course, there are other special relations between classes. We can define class hierarchies. So what is a subclass? What is a superclass? And we can also define hierarchies among properties. What is a subproperty? What is a superproperty? Okay, let's start with the classes. First, each class that we define must be of type RDFS class. So you see here we have again a name prefix that is used for the RDFS namespace. And with RDFS class, you can define abstract objects, which is applied via RDF type to create instances of this class. With RDF property, this is the base class for properties. Then, of course, if you define a property, it must be of that type. And, of course, you can define that some object, for example, has to be of type literal. Then you also have the base class for all literals. It's RDFS literal. And in the end, of course, all these things are a subclass of some top class, which is on top of all class hierarchies, and that is an RDF resource. So everything you model in the end will be some kind of resource. So everything in RDF is a resource, so it's of class RDF resource in general. And then, of course, you have a general class for data types, you have a general class for literals that stem from XML schema definition. We know that we can use some data types that come from XML schema. Then, of course, we have a class for RDS container, which are these aggregations or lists of RDF statements. And to be a member of an RDF container, you have also so-called RDF container membership properties, where you define properties that define nothing else but a membership to a given container. Let's take a look at a simple example where classes are used. So here, for example, we have a simple statement here, Semantic Web Technologies, which is a lecture, is managed by a person, Harald Sack, that's me. So Semantic Web Technologies refers to a class, so it's a class. Then you have another statement that you say Semantic Web Technologies is of RDF type lecture, and lecture is a class. So lecture is of RDF type class. And again, here you have a person, and this person belongs to stuff. So it's of RDF type stuff, and stuff also is an RDFS class. And as we can see here, these two classes, of course, are subclass of RDFS resource, which is the top class of all classes in RDFS. And then on the other hand, we have here a property, and the property here is managed by, states itself by RDF type that it is a property. And of course, a property always relates one class with another, so you have to define which is the domain class and which is the range class, and to this we come now. So we have properties. We have special properties that are predefined in RDF, which are first case for defining class or property hierarchies. So we have RDFS subclass of, and we have RDFS subproperty of, which are transitive properties to define inheritance hierarchies for classes or properties. And on the other hand, if you define a new property, then you have to define the domain from a class which is mapped to another class, which is the range. So you have to define an RDFS domain and an RDFS range. So these are two properties that relate the property you define to its domain and to its range. Short example, again, you see here, we have the example that Semantic Web Technologies is managed by me, and then you have here, of course, this is of type lecture. Lecture is a subclass of course, and course then again is a class. And here you have is managed by, which is a property, and you define then the domain of this property, which is the course, which is a class. And on the other hand, you define the range, which is the stuff, which is also a class. So you see here, defining conceptual models like this is pretty simple with RDFS. So you have here in blue the RDFS part, and below there the RDF part. This is the instantiation of this terminological knowledge. And this terminological knowledge, which is expressed by classes and relations between classes, this is the so-called ontology, or the terminological part of the RDFS knowledge base. Let's take a look at a simplified version of the general RDFS language model. So right at the top, we have the RDFS resource. Everything is a resource. And of course, also RDFS resource is some type of a class, so it's type of a class. But everything is subclass of resource, therefore RDFS class is subclass of this resource. And again, also RDFS class is defined to be an RDFS class in itself. So you see here the two different type of relations. In red, you see here the type of relation. In black, you see the subclass relation. Then we have the RDFS literal, which is, of course, also a class, but is also a subclass of resource. We have the RDF property here. You must be careful. It's not RDFS, but it's RDF. It's because it stems from the RDF resource vocabulary and not from the RDFS resource vocabulary, but never mind that. So this again is a subclass of resource, but also RDF property, of course, has to be or must be a class. And then you have lots of properties that are predefined. For example, we have RDF type, which is of type property. We have RDFS command. We will come to that later. We have RDFS subclass of, subproperty of, and domain and range, which are also domains, which are also properties, of course. This is only a very simplified version of the entire language model. The entire RDF and RDFS vocabulary can be put in relations like that, and you can look it up simply in the W3C RDFS primer, where the definition of this language model is given in an explicit way. Okay, let's come to some further properties that we should also consider. So, for example, we can say that there is a relation between two things, between one instance of a property and another, and this is the C also property. It means you can also look up some other resource that explains the resource we are talking about. So it's the C also relation. And if you do it in a formal way, a subproperty of C also is the is defined by, and this defines a relation of a resource and its definition. And if you only have to make some comment about something, which is not a definition in that way, then you use the property RDFS comment. And in general, it is agreed on that if you name resources, you usually take the property RDFS label, and behind RDFS label, there is always a readable, for man it means, or for human, readable name of a resource. And this is contrary to an ID, which might be some alphanumeric string that must not be readable, but or that need not to be readable. This has to be readable. It's the real name of the resource we are talking about. So this is generally agreed upon. Okay, to sum it up, in short, we have here again the RDFS knowledge base we have talked about. In blue, you have the so-called terminological knowledge, which consists of classes and properties, and of course, relations between all these constituents. And in white, you have the so-called ABOX, which is the assertional knowledge within the RDFS knowledge base. What's missing? Let's take a look at the according turtle encoding of these RDFS statements. We have seen on the last slide in the form of an RDF graph. Okay, we start here with two prefixes. Of course, we need the prefix for RDF and here also for RDFS. And then we start, for example, we can define a course, which is a class. And then we can say there's also a lecture, which is also a class. And then here you see the lecture in itself is a subclass of course. And then we also define a seminar, and a seminar then also is a class and a subclass, of course. So this is a pretty short definition. Then, besides the course, we need the person we are talking about. Therefore, we have the class person, which is an RDFS class. And then we define special kind of persons, the staff of the university. So staff is also a class, and it's a subclass of person, because everybody of the staff is also a person. And then we define two more special classes, which will be the professor and the senior researcher. And here, the senior researcher is a class and is a subclass of staff. And also, the professor is a subclass of staff. Then we define, in the end, the property that connects the course and the staff. And therefore, we have to define here the domain of this property is managed by, which is the course, and the range, which is the staff. And then we have here, in the upper part, these three parts, these three paragraphs. This is the terminological knowledge of our RDFS database, and then here comes the assertional knowledge, which consists of a few simple RDF statements. Here we say that Semantic Web Technologies is a lecturer, and then we say that I am a senior researcher, and then Semantic Web Technology is managed by me. So that's it in the end with RDFS. Okay. To sum it up somehow, RDFS, or RDFS schema, is a language that defines a data model for the definition of simple ontologies, simple knowledge representations. We will see that it's really not quite much that we have now. For example, we don't have something like a negation, so it will be rather difficult, for example, to create inconsistencies and failures. So everything you define here is potentially true, but we will come back to that later on. And via these RDFS schema ontologies, statements or facts about individuals can be expressed. And of course, this is more than pure XML, because in XML there was no ontological agreement about what a label that you define really means. So what you have here, you have a small vocabulary with an exact meaning. It means these things that we have learned, what is an RDFS class, what is an RDF property, this has a specific meaning. So it's interpreted in the way that, of course, this word means that it's a class, and we must, of course, define what is a class. So what's missing now is just some kind of a formal semantics. It means that defines the meaning of these things we are talking about. But up to now, we are just learning about the vocabulary. And in natural language, I will give the explanation what the simple vocabulary term means. In the end, of course, for the machine to understand this, we need a formal representation of that. And this will be done via logic. OK. But in the next part of the lecture, we want to ask the question, OK, so what can I really express with the RDF and the RDFS we know so far? And where are the limits of it?